A retro cut there, Thin Lizzy. Don't believe a word. On XFM 104.9, I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve Merchant. Bubba Doo Boo, who's that over there? It's Carly Pilk Boys. Here I come.
Oh, that's clever.
How you doing?
Yeah, I'm alright, yeah.
Yeah, come on, up, 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 bigger bagadoo. Up, 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 yeah? Project, project. There's people out there wanting to, you know, cheer up their Saturday afternoon. We're the boys for it, yeah? We're like quick, quick fitters.
Yeah,
come on.
Alright, Carl?
Yeah, yeah.
Come on!
Come on!
I'm alright, I'm up for it.
That's it, this is the height of excitement.
This is it, is it?
That's
this
how
is
you train when you're 100%.
This is you off your head, is it? High on life. Christ. What did Suzanne say about you saying about a big ass? Go on.
She heard about it.
Should we recap what happened last week?
Well, the week before, he said that, her haircut looked like Dave Hill from Slade. She didn't like that. So, next week I said, she was a bit grumpy, went, yeah, I didn't mention her fat ass. Still thinking that she would never hear about this. Yeah. What happened when you went home?
She heard about that off a mate.
Yeah.
And we sorted it out. Didn't have to buy her anything. I just sort of said, come on, you know what the show's about and that. Stop moaning.
Yeah.
Right. That was alright until about Thursday, when I was reading about, do you know, like, they say there's like, two worlds and that, and, whatever I'm doing now here, there's another one of me doing the same.
Yeah. But-
Well, no, he's probably taking some time off. He's probably having a week off.
Yeah.
But I was just talking about that, and she was saying, nah, that doesn't happen. And I sort of said, well, they definitely won't have a haircut like yours. Right?
And
that sort of started the argument again.
It's almost like you haven't learnt your lesson. Also, it's like you're talking about it again on air, almost, in a way, so her mates could hear again. It's very short learning curve. You know, Carl, if there was if I cut a hole in a box and you knew there was an orange in there, right, and you put your hand in, would you be stuck there trying to get that orange out, do you think? Or would you just, like, let it go and sort of tip it upside down to get it out?
What do you mean?
I think that answers your question. Is that a cardboard box on your hand? So is there any other things you want to criticise Suzanne for while we're on air? Anything else, anything that's been niggling that you feel you should get off your chest? The hair, the arse?
Leave it.
I think so.
Okay.
That's good. I think leave it. Well done.
Now can we just check what other big Carl features have we got today? We got Monkey News.
Got Monkey News that's coming important. Up, yeah. We've got a bit of, got Rockbusters.
Uh-huh.
And, the film thing. That,
still not got a name.
Yeah.
The film thing.
Just me and a film and that.
Mm-hmm.
And,
brilliant.
This week, we're digging out the old, the one when I'm in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Right, so you're gonna make
Jack Nicholson. Brilliant film.
Yeah.
Yeah, brilliant film. It was my favourite film till I saw Godfather.
It's better than that.
Well, you know, yeah, some would say that, yeah.
No, it is. The storyline's more interesting.
I didn't know there was an actual answer. I didn't. sorry, it's what's best?
One Flew Over the Cuckoo's
Nest. Is it?
Nest.
Okay.
That's fact, Rick.
Oh, right. Okay. Where's Godfather? Because I want to know, because I don't embarrass myself. Or is it my fourth favourite film or something, or?
Probably about fifth.
In my fifth favourite film, is it? Brilliant.
Talking of lists.
I suppose I like Kez and the Elephant Man, do I?
Do you?
Lists, yeah. Rick. I don't know if you saw in the paper. I think it's on TV this evening. It's, as voted for by viewers of VH1, the music channel, and they've basically come up with a list of the greatest pop culture icons, ever. There's 100.
Where's Elvis?
So Elvis, is, for instance, is number 3.
Jimmy Dean in there?
James Dean is in there. I think he's a bit lower. Let me see. He's, number 22. We got David Beckham at number 1.
Oh, well, okay, well then, so Robbie Williams is in there, so it's British bias.
Yeah, Robbie Williams is number 9. He's just below ABBA.
Oh, okay.
Eight. But, interestingly, this is of interest to you, I think, number 66.
Yeah.
The Office.
That's right.
Well, it is, Rick. It's nice that the show is in there and that. Yeah. That's a very flattering thing. I tell you what cheapens it. I tell you what undermines it.
Yeah.
The things that are lower in the list than the show.
Oh, God. So we've beaten...
Well, I'll give you a little test.
Yeah.
Higher or lower? Do you think this is higher, near the top of most important pop culture icons, or lower than ours? Okay, I'm going to give you, Superman.
Well, international, been around since the 30s, one of the biggest icons on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say higher.
Lower.
But, yeah?
Ludicrous.
Okay.
Do you think higher or lower? Neil Armstrong, the first man on the moon. This guy's been to the moon.
Well, I'd say lower then.
Lower?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, but is that saying the people behind the rocket or just him? Because he just sat in it, didn't he? He just sat there, yeah, he didn't do anything.
But, no, but it's the
icon.
It's what
he's symbolic
it's not,
of.
It's, yeah, it's not what, how much work went into it.
Alright.
A few others.
What about things like Coca-Cola?
Oh no, they don't really count. It tends to be-
Oh, so it's not-
They don't feature. I mean, Mickey Mouse is in there. What do you make- what do you reckon? Tom Cruise, higher or lower? Tom Cruise is the number one box office movie star in the world.
Well, presumably lower,
he's
then.
Lower. He's number 81. Just about scraped in there. And it really is a list drawn up by people who've just sat at home and looked along their video and book collection.
Yeah.
Office, well, yeah, that's good.
Well, I think it is a reflection of that, but it's always the same that they, you do an HMV poll and it's Pet Sounds, Revolver, Let's Get It On, yeah. Robbie Williams, Life Through a Lens.
Exactly.
Because it's, you know, it's the people that vote, it's a reflection of like those massive, you yeah. know, what's big at the moment. I was the most powerful man in comedy, let's not forget.
Yes.
1 year ago. Yeah. Wonder where I'll be this year.
See, if that had been the laziest man in comedy,
yeah, yeah.
you'd have got my vote.
Yeah.
Interestingly though, at number 26, Carl Pilkington.
Oh, imagine. Oh. All possibilities, badly drawn by on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais with me, Steve Merchant, and little Carly Pilkoids.
Rick, Susie's emailed.
Yeah.
She wondered if you could give a massive hello to Hannah and Charlotte and all in the sixth form at Cobthorpe School.
Yeah.
If you want to listen, would you give them a massive
yeah,
hello?
Yeah, shout out, yeah,
yeah no,
massive.
Suspect, man.
Where are they from?
I don't know, I can't quite pronounce it. Cobthorpe School?
Cobthorpe or? Massive.
Yeah.
They're probably Cobthorpe known
massive,
as.
Yeah.
yeah.
So good luck to Sue's and Hans and Charles.
When did we start doing dedications?
I feel we should, because I've always felt this is something that's lacking on the show. Interaction with the audience, you know?
Interesting only to the one person whose
yeah,
name is mentioned.
Of course. But that's, yeah. how, that's how proper DJs fill out their time. They don't talk about monkeys and, you know, and all that kind of drivel.
Oh. Do you think monkeys are drivel, Carl?
We'll still be doing a bit of monkey news. It doesn't
yeah,
matter
yeah.
how much you have a pop at it. It's coming up in a bit.
Yeah.
Got some good stuff this week. I know it's been a bit dull
yeah.
last 2 weeks.
Well,
know.
No, it's not been dull. It's been totally untrue.
As ever.
Bordering what? On the impossible. I mean, monkey dating, saying, what tree are we meeting in?
Mm, well.
You believe that sort of drivel.
Mm.
So, I mean, oh, God. Jonathan Ross told a story about a chimpanzee once.
Go on.
It was about, but it was about how it escaped from the zoo,
yeah.
and it jumped on a bus.
Right.
Okay. Interesting. Funny.
I
right?
did that one.
But it's possible, is there possibility in that
yeah,
one
but
being
I did
true?
That. I did that one.
I think you said something like he drove the bus, or he was conducting it, or
I think
fares.
You said he took it to Spain.
Hmm.
Do you see the difference? It's that little stretch of credibility that means it's all shite.
How is Jonathan Ross? All right. Is he? I wondered how long it would take before his name popped up. How is he? How is the old man? Looking forward to his birthday Monday?
Oh, dear. Yeah.
I don't know if any of the listeners saw Ricky on Jonathan Ross's TV show last night.
Yeah.
What? I mean, man alive.
What?
Well, that's not an interview. How is that an interview?
What?
It's not, he wasn't interviewing you, he's like two pals just having a laugh. And
really?
If we had, it was like it was a family do, and you just happened to film it and stick it on the telly. My friend made a good point, it was like any minute his kids were gonna pop out, sit on that sofa next to you and go, oh, Uncle Ricky, do the little dance. It was unbelievable. I mean, what were you wearing, for a start? What's that? Some tatty old jumper like you'd just been doing some artexing and you'd gone pot round, Rick, we're having a couple of drinks.
That was Lambretta.
Lambretta. Was it trendy, inside out?
Trendy jumper.
How do you keep getting things with the St. George cross on it?
What do you mean? That's the only one I've
got. You've got loads of stuff. T-shirts, jumpers, shoes.
No, I've got a Union
underpants.
Jacket. What's it? A French Connection one?
But that's
one.
Not the- that's not my concern.
I haven't got any underpants!
That's not my concern, no, it's just the fact that- I mean, firstly-
Yeah.
The fact that Ricky- for those of you who don't realise, Ricky is friends with Jonathan Ross. They are friends. Now, they've only known each other, what, a year, maybe?
About two, yeah.
It's less- I think it's less than two. And what worries me is, the friendship's too close.
What do you
because
mean?
Because you're over 40. You see, it seems to me that after the age of 25, men should not be becoming really close friends with other men. It should be like you've had all your friends, you made them at university, at school, And if you were in a way walk of life and you met someone at a party or a pub, even if you got on, you would not be phoning them every other day, like going to an awards. What are you wearing, Jonathan? I've heard this conversation. What are you wearing? I think I might wear this. Is it too formal? Is that going to be too formal?
It's not true.
It is. You're always on the phone to him. You're always chatting. I'm just going to pop around. Oh, I'm just going to play some tennis.
Yeah, we play tennis.
Always hanging out with the guy. And it's to me, it's unhealthy. And this, it's just bled over now onto TV.
Hold on, wait a minute.
So, you're there. It's like, I'll tell you what it reminded me of. Des O'Connor and Jethro. Coming on to plug his live video.
Or Tommy and Kenny Lynch.
And then at the end of the interview, after they've been, you know, mutually backslapping. He gave you a pet. Jonathan Ross gave you a cat as a replacement for your cat which died. Yeah. Now, to me, that's an inappropriate gift.
Why? It's a lovely gift.
I don't think people should be giving pets
gifts. Do you know what I've got in
there for his birthday? Imagine turning up to a wedding with, I just bought you a cat.
Do you know what I've got in for his birthday? I've got him a child.
Well, you may as well, because that's what it's like, a cat to me.
I've got a small Rwandan child.
A cat to me is like, I've bought you this small child. I was going to sponsor him, but I got a bit of cash, I've flown him over. it's too intimate, it's too much responsibility.
Do you know what I think, Carl?
Go on.
I think Steve's a bit jealous.
I'll tell you, I've got good reason to be jealous.
What?
I've got good reason to be jealous, I just remembered this. Your birthday?
Yeah.
Jonathan Ross was there. Carl Pilkington was there.
Yeah.
I don't remember being invited. I don't remember being invited. Was I there, Carl? You were there. I don't remember being there.
Yeah, but you're with him all day and that.
Right,
so.
Okay. Well, yeah, but he sees you a lot. I mean, Jonathan, he's round his house every other day playing tennis and who else knows what, swimming together and sat in his jacuzzi, cracking wise. What happened there? What happened there?
Oh, we've got to the bottom of it. Play a record.
The villa that we went to afterwards could only sleep six.
It may as well have been. How is the cat? All right?
Yeah,
what's your name? Jonathan?
Ollie. Hey-ya! Outcast, XFM, 104.9, Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington. It's that time, isn't it? Rockbusters.
Whee!
Come on, Carl, what you got for us?
Alright, well, do you want to say what the prizes are?
The prizes are better away than that.
Really?
I'll
be the judge of that.
Actually, what am I talking about? No, there's a two-disc set, Rock and Roll Legends, on the cover there. We've got Buddy Holly, Elvis, Roy Orbison. And Little Richard, so
no one wants that, baby.
Nobody's interested. Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, a DVD. I'm a Nick Cave fan and I wouldn't watch it.
No, you'd watch it once at most when there was nothing else.
Knowing me, knowing you.
No, I mean, Nick Cave's good, but when do you watch rock DVDs?
Yeah. Knowing me, knowing you. Great series, obviously, but once again, on VHS. Who wants it on VHS? Yeah. Where are all the bonus features?
Absolute pointless.
The only thing
far.
That's half decent is this enormous hardback League of Gentlemen book, which is the scripts and all sorts of other stuff. If you're a League of Gentlemen fan, you'll love it. If you're not, I guess it's a good Christmas gift.
If you're not a League of Gentlemen, there's nothing in this for you.
No, exactly.
So...
So, you know, you can either enter for the hell of it.
A pile of rubbish. What's the story? Well, not as bad as the competition, I suppose, so... No. Go on.
Well, you know how it works. Cryptic clue.
It's not really cryptic. It's usually wrong.
It kind of is.
Yeah.
Right, so the first one, there's three of them, you get them right, you win the stuff. First one,
I'll get them close, I mean, because... You could win this if you got one right, possibly.
If you go to Chepstow, you will.
Was that a clue or is that a point? Is that something?
That's a clue.
Right. All right. Say it again.
If you go to Chepstow, you will.
And what are the initials?
Just S.
Just S. All right.
Second one. E.T. is upset. What's up with him? All right. E.T. is upset. What's he upset for? What's wrong with him? All right.
Different. So not cryptic, so.
M.E. The initials there.
N.E.
M.
M.E.
M for mother. M.E. Right, and the third one, I had a tape with,
Jesus.
imagine
Bob Holness doing this against, in the gold run, against the clock. Right, I had a tape, no, I had a tape with some,
I had a tape with, like, Humpty Dumpty on it, and Hickory Dickory Dock and that on it. But I've broke it. Alright?
Constantly listening to trying to figure them out.
Trying to solve the crime.
Exactly.
Who pushed Humpty?
Yeah.
The initials there, B-R. Right? So, first one, if you go to Chepstow, you will. The initial, S. E.T.'s, ET's upset. What's up with him?
Yeah.
What's up with ET?
I don't know.
What's up with ET? ET's upset. What's up with ET?
Yeah. The initials there, M-E, is that
right? Yeah. Yeah. Let's go through that one more time. Yeah. If you go to Chepstow,
they're
you
like
might-
They're like jazz questions.
Yeah, exactly.
Just free form.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. E.T.'s a bit upset. What's gay? What's that- What- Hey, dude, what's the matter, man?
And they had a tape with, like, Umpty Dumpty on it, Hickory Dickory Dock, stuff like that. Doesn't work anymore. What's gone on there, right?
What's gone on there?
B-R.
First time we said, well, you broke it.
Well, I broke it, then.
Yeah. Is that important or not?
Yeah. I broke it.
And right. It's B.
B R.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Well, you can text if you have a mobile phone. So everyone, there's no excuse to not take part. 83XFM is the text. 83XFM. Or the phone number. No, not the phone. Obviously, we don't.
I think I know what the B might stand for.
And otherwise, it's Ricky.Gervais at XFM.co.uk. We'd love to hear from you.
Oh, it just sucks the lifeblood out of me, just listening to Rockbusters.
Something to bring you down even further, although it's a beautiful, beautiful tune.
Oh, beautiful.
Ryan Adams has got a number of different albums out at the moment. One is called Rock and Roll. It's not great, don't really bother with that one. Do dig out, though, Love is Hell Part 1 from Ryan Adams. It's available at different places, and you'll find this on it. Track 5, Wonderwall, his version of Oasis.
Absolutely
is wonderful.
Absolutely beautiful, isn't it?
It's a treat. It's XFM, 104.9.
Yeah. Fortune Faded, Red Hot Chili Peppers on XFM 104.9.
You, of course, don't ever take the tube anywhere, Rick.
No.
You haven't done that for years.
No.
Take cars everywhere or you walk.
Yeah.
Or you get a lift from Jonathan. But me, I'm still forced to take the tube, which is also very embarrassing at the moment because
those
posters.
You're not forced to take the tube, are you?
I am.
What do you mean you're
forced? What, am I made of money?
Well, you could
How
walk.
Else am I going to get a bank?
You could walk.
What?
You can drive, won't you buy a car?
Oh yeah, driving into the centre of town? Congestion charge, are you paying that? Are you a fiver?
Hey? What do you think of that, Carl? Hey?
oh yeah, cause he's Mr. Flush. He's Mr. Lavish with his cash.
Well, no, I've moved in closer, haven't I? I'm not moaning about it. I walk everywhere now.
Well, good. Yeah. I'm pleased for you.
I moaned about it, but then I sorted it out.
But you're always whinging anyway. Let's not get on to you, Carl. It's always you.
Yeah.
So,
what's up with Steve today, do you think, Carl?
I don't know, what's going on?
He's having a go, isn't he?
Yeah.
It's not helping those posters being on the tube of us. That's not helping. I don't know if you've seen those posters. You'd obviously not go.
I haven't seen them on the tube, but.
Everywhere I go, I'm stood next to one. I can't avoid it.
Yeah.
I'm on the tube waiting. I look around and I say, oh, it's us again. And it's so embarrassing. Well, because it looks like you're stood next to it deliberately.
But I can't browse in HMV now. I went last week and, you keep coming up to pictures or cardboard cutouts of Brent, right?
Yeah.
And, I was in a bookshop and I was looking at, there's a big almanac of comedy. Right, and I was just looking through it, just browsing, right, killing time, and there was a picture of me, and just as I started looking at this write-up of the office, a tap on the shoulder, it was one of the worst there, said, do you mind signing some script books? Mm. So she saw me looking at myself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I wanted to go, you know, I just turned to that page then.
Yeah, I was in a bookshop looking, and there was a big book on sitcoms, it was like the A to Z of sitcoms or something like that, and I genuinely was looking up other shows, because it was about other comedy shows.
Like, yeah.
And I was looking something up, guy that I knew came up to me, like that, and I decided, like, oh, I'm just looking, oh, Robin's Nest, where's that? Birds of a Feather, I just got a... Because it's like, I'm interested in comedy before the fact I got in comedy, so I will buy a book on comedy.
Exactly, yeah.
But on the tube, it's real awkward because it's like, it's everywhere I walk, they're kind of around the corner, so you don't sort of expect them. And then I'm sort of running now from kind of corridor to corridor, pillar to pillar, to avoid being stood next to this picture. Yeah. In case I look like someone who stands next to this picture, trying to get recognised.
Imagine that! Oh, of course Carl didn't want his little round bald head.
No.
On that.
Yeah. But, I was on the tube today, and, you know, sometimes you can't help but overhear a conversation.
Yeah.
And, this woman, there were two friends, they were sat there, and one woman said, she just said, I must tell you this. I was in the pub last night, and, Dave called, and I said, Dave, he said, I can't hear you. I said, Dave, it's not, he said, I can't hear you. So I held the phone up so he could hear all the noise in the pub. Ugh.
That was it.
That was the anecdote. That was the story. And I wanted to lean over to her friend and say, unless this woman has given you a kidney or saved you from drowning, do not be friends with her. break up this friendship.
She hasn't got anecdotes.
Because what's that? And I've got acquaintances like that where you know you speak to me, you get cornered at a party, you know this is the person who has not got anecdotes. The anecdotes, they're not stories.
Yeah,
they just,
yeah.
That's it. It's like you're expecting for something else to happen. Never does.
Well, I was with Danny Baker yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
He's brilliant bloke. First time I met him, and we got on like a house on fire.
Put your his number straight in your mobile.
Well, we've exchanged numbers, because he's got some great anecdotes.
You had to delete mine, because you only got so many.
I might write with him, because he's funny. He did this thing, and it was absolutely brilliant. He's doing he wrote a documentary, and he's a great guy. He's funny as well, you know what I mean?
It's the showbiz friendship. That's what I loathe, I think. It's the fact that, like, somehow, you're sort of, because it's like you haven't got to go through the formalities of making friends with someone, because they, I respect your work, you respect mine, you know I'm a funny guy, you've seen my work, let's be friends, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And it's like, and it just, it's a horrible kind of icky sort of...
Listen, Steve, me and you are going to stay in touch, whatever. So, I mean, probably not my birthday this year, but next year,
sure.
We'd have known each other, what, 7, 8 years?
Yeah.
So come to that one.
Yeah.
Well, can I
do
tell
I need
what?
To wear the waiter's outfit again?
Oh, God! Oh, dear. P.I.M.P. by 50 Cent. Or 50 Cent, as I call him. XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, you're Stephen Merchant. There's little Carl Pilkingbod over there. Alright?
Alright. Yeah, not bad. Listen,
Oh, he's perked up.
Yeah.
Oh, he's back in the area. Well, you got something to say?
I was kept quiet in the first hour. I'll let you get on with it now.
What you got to say? Is it, just don't have a guess, is it about monkeys, Chinese people, or little gay fellas?
It's about little gay fellas.
Sure. Is it?
Of course it is.
Go on.
Yeah, but not because I like chicken
making that. Sorry, let me just note that, don't
you? No, but it fascinates me, doesn't it? All stuff like that, that's a bit sort of different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that.
What, like monkeys and Chinese people?
Well, and that thing you were showing me before, the half woman.
No, you weren't impressed with that.
Well, no.
You know, that woman that's got two pieces of genetic makeup in her, where it was two separate sperms and two separate eggs fused, and she came out as sort of a normal person, but she had this residue of genetic material, and so she's had two children that aren't genetically the same as her.
Yeah.
Right? And they showed it in the paper by doing her half white and half black to show the two different, you know what I mean? Just for it, he went, does she look like that? I said, well, of course not. He went, not interested then.
Of course. Yeah.
He said, how could I tell? Not interested in that at all.
Yeah.
If I'd have said she'd given birth to a monkey, fascinated, straight away.
Well, anyway.
Go on.
But that's what I'm saying, I'm just interested in weird stuff, right?
Yeah.
So
am I. That's why you're on the show.
Talking about little gay fellas and that.
Yeah.
Northern Line. Beach, underground tube thing.
Not the boy band.
Right.
Right. Yeah. Apparently, on a Saturday night, late, I don't know what that is. What time late is in the sort of gay community. As we've discussed before, but apparently the last carriage on the Northern Line, they all get in there.
What do you mean they all get in there?
They sort of take over the last carriage of the Northern Line on a Saturday night.
Right.
And it's like the gay carriage.
Right. And what exactly do they do? They just travel about on the Northern Line?
No, just have a chat and that, and like, just
stick on the communards.
How do you know?
Someone told me.
See, I mean, I'm glad you've informed me, because it wouldn't bother me, but I feel I should be told about these things, because I'm likely to stumble onto that carriage by mistake, and it's not that it'd be a problem, it's just I might feel a little uncomfortable if there's a lot of people in, you know, the black the black leather gear and the moustaches, the hats.
I mean, to be quite honest, they'd be annoyed.
Of course.
Because they'd be expecting something a little bit, you know.
What do you mean?
Well.
They're good-looking, most of them.
Sure.
No, they are good-looking fellas, though, aren't they?
What do you mean?
What do you mean?
They're just a lot of the gay, you know, they look after themselves and that and look good, keep themselves.
Some of them work out, yeah.
You see, this is the problem I have, because there's a lot of areas in London and elsewhere in the country where there's a sort of, you know, it's a gay thing, you know, it's a gay public toilet, or I don't mean it's gay, but it's not, like, legal thing.
It means a cottage.
But it's a cottage, whatever. I mean, I remember being, in Bristol once, doing some-
You're confused when I said it's a cottage. Yeah. That's a term for where gay people go in toilets to sort of meet and greet each other.
Well, I
shake hands.
I was at the public library in Bristol once, doing some studies from a sixth form,
yeah.
And I think the toilet was closed in the library, and I was dying for the toilet, and I popped out, and there was a public toilet behind the library. I thought, I can't believe my luck. Dashed down there, it was about six-ish in the evening, I was working late, I was studying hard.
Yeah.
I went in there, and I swear to God, I saw two fellas. With the-
Is that unusual, or?
Well, no, they were up to some hijinks.
What they sort of like-
Do you know the thing that struck me?
What?
One of them had bright red underpants.
What do you mean?
They were having some kind of, you know, what? They were having relations. They weren't even in a cubicle, they were out in the-
Where were the underpants?
Around his ankles.
No!
Yes! I swear to God, I'm not gonna make this up!
What, how old were you?
I don't know, like, how old you are in the sixth form? 16 or whatever, 17?
Yeah, and what did you do?
Well, I actually said-
Well, you just joined in, what else did you do? You might as well, yeah.
I actually swore, I said, oh, F me. And then I went, oh, no, no, I did, I swear to God. I did. I went, oh, if me. No, don't. Because I was panicked. And I ran out. And as I was walking out, a guy was coming in. I went, oh, hang on, mate. And then I thought, I better not tell him. I'll let him find out for himself. He might be going in there to join in. He might have got a call. Come down. We're going crazy on each other's ass. Come down.
It's a conspiracy of Bristol
conspiracy. But what annoyed me was, my lover.
What a bit of car.
What angered me, Rick, was the fact that I wasn't notified, that there was not- I didn't know-
There was no sign.
And afterwards, I spoke to other people about it, and they said, oh, it's a famous gay haunt. But what annoys me is I feel that they should put an ad in the local press,
yeah.
A big paper, like once a week, like, you know, when they recall cars if they're damaged or there's a fault, or couriers might bring back stuff if they're sort of faulty goods, they say recall and we'll give you money back.
What do you suggest?
The gay community should put an advert in that just says, these are the hot spots, this is where you're likely to find us doing some stuff. If you're not gay and you might feel uncomfortable, avoid them. And just list them, or little pictures, or, you know, a map or something. Anything, because like the gay tube thing, I don't know-
Cock van, 1, 2, 3, railway cuttings.
Well, not that, it's more of a sort of social awareness thing.
Yeah.
So people, you know, don't feel uncomfortable and-
But they don't want it exactly to be like, sort of walking in under a neon sign.
Why? It's legal.
yeah, big arrows. Oh, as if.
What do you mean? What's wrong with that?
Because, well, it's actually a public place. I don't think cottaging is strictly legal.
But then even if they specify what they're going to do.
But some people, they're not, some of them aren't, I don't think it's probably seen gays, is it?
Yeah, but it's not
the people that go out and they say I'm gay and I like Barbara Streisand. It's presumably the sort of people that do that are people that either aren't quite out yet or, do you know what I mean? Or they're doing having a quick run over the way to their wife and kids.
Yeah.
I don't know completely how it works, but I'm sure there probably isn't a place like, free bumming here tonight.
No, there is kind of.
What?
Because I was walking home one night through Soho, right? Mm. Just because that's the way I have to go, not because of you know what I mean? I wasn't going there on that, right? So I'm walking
so
through,
funny.
Right? And, I was handed, like, a card, which was like a gay event, yep. Right? Now that's a bit weird, isn't it? That straight away he's presuming that because I'm there that time of night.
Well, and you've got a shaved head and you sort of like, you know, you sort of like quite look after yourself and you've got some nice clothes.
Yeah, but it's still, you
And you look like
really
a little
presume.
Bit rough, don't you, from Manchester. You look like a northern rent boy who comes down to stand outside McDonald's.
But the card was rubbish, right?
What do you mean?
Had this fella on it, yeah. Right? All sort of greased up and that.
What would you look?
Just having a look, what he'd handed me and that.
Right.
Just having a look. Picture of him, sort of sailor's hat on, tan body, like, just his arse out, like that. And, rubbish slogan, right? The best bum in W1.
Is bum there a noun, or like a verb?
What do you mean?
Well, to bum. Is it like, get the best bum you've ever had, or he had the best bum?
I think it's just
I don't suppose you asked.
No.
I don't suppose you called the number to check. What do you mean exactly by this? Does it mean you've got a great ass?
Do you mean I will be well bummed, or do you mean you've just got a good-
Come on now, let's-
Well,
just a final point about- Because I asked my friend how it all works up on the Heath, because I live in Hampstead Heath, near Hampstead, and I was worried I didn't want to go walking and get myself involved in it.
How can you get involved?
No, but again, I didn't want to walk
Oh, you believe it. I couldn't say no. Oh, my wrist, it's knackered. What do you mean? Well, I was there for about 2 hours, I must have gone about 43 of them. But, you know, I didn't like to say no, because they were so pleased to see me. Oh,
God. Well, it's not so much the fear of that, it's not-
Good skiing practice, I was doing two at a time for a little while.
It's not the fear of that so much as the fact that, again, you don't want to gatecrash someone else's party. You don't, do you know what I mean?
No.
You don't, if there was a straight couple having sex, you'd want, oh, I'm sorry, and you'd want to avoid that area.
Of course.
But I find, so someone told me, how it works, and apparently you just go and, you know, sit on a bench or something, and then a guy just sits on the bench, and they just look at each other. There's not really anything said, it's just a kind of nice evening or whatever. You know, I guess it's like 2 a.m. or whatever. And then they go off in the bushes and ding dong. But it's like, I don't know how that culture's developed.
I love this programme.
Why can't that be the case with women? That would be amazing. You just go out to the park at like 1 a.m, you just sit on a bench. You just
be like a scene from Gigi.
Exactly.
Where he's just walking along with a perambulator.
Yeah. Exactly. But that would just be a joy if there was none of this formality. You've got to talk to them, buy them dinner.
Oh,
you know,
joking.
Romance.
Oh, no.
Just this kind of informal thing. It'd be great.
So what would you do then? You'd go up to a woman and go, come on.
Yeah.
Let's stop mucking around.
We know why we're both sat on this bench.
There's a nice bush over there.
Yeah.
Let's have a bit.
Yeah, and then she'd go, yeah, great, thanks. I'm killing some time before I, you know, pop into town.
Yeah.
That'd be perfect, thanks. You make my weekend.
So you're jealous of gays as well as me?
In a sense. In a way.
What do you think, Carl?
Let's put a track on.
Why? You're getting scared now.
Yeah. You brought it up.
Is it getting too close to the bone, so to speak? Radiohead and There on XFM. I'm Ricky Gervais, with me Steve Merchant and Carl Pilkington.
I was talking to my dad the other day, he was saying, he lived in Bristol and my family live in Bristol, and so they can't really listen to the show. And he said, I was thinking of buying your grandparents a digital radio for Christmas so they can listen to your show. Imagine them listening to that last link.
About you?
And then me seeing them at Christmas. Steve, you never told us you saw two blokes bumming.
Yeah, and then what's that about you jacking off 30 men?
Exactly.
You've got to say no, lad. I know you're a nice fella, but just because they want relief, you're not the man for it.
Oh dear. You must be so proud.
Yeah.
Rockbusters.
Yeah, they'd be loving this, right? three clues were, first one. If you go to Chepstow, you will, right? The initial was S. That was seahorses. All right. That was the answer there.
I'll give you that.
That's fair enough.
I'll give you that.
E.T.'s upset. What's wrong with E.T.? What's wrong with him?
Yeah, right.
The initials M.E.
Yeah.
What's up with him? It was Missy Elliott. All right, Elliott.
Doesn't count at all.
What?
Doesn't count at all.
Missy Elliott. You know what I mean? What's wrong with E.T.?
What is that with him?
No, well, just let him explain it. Sorry, Carl. Do it again. Well, I wasn't listening. Do it again.
Elliott, yeah.
Yeah.
Who's in E.T.?
Yeah, I'll just do the clue again.
Right. E.T.'s upset. Yeah. So he's looking a bit sad in that. What's
what,
up with
E.T. the extraterrestrial?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Right, and his mate,
yeah,
who's in it, it's called Elliot.
Yeah,
right, he's upset. What's up with him? Well, he's Missy Elliot.
Missy Elliot, what's she got to do with it though? I don't understand.
No, the way you'd say it, you say, "What's up, E.T.?" and it go, oh, "Missy Elliot."
Why would you mention her? I don't understand. Was she in? Was it a thing in the film?
Missing.
She wasn't even around.
Oh, missing?
Oh, Missing Elliot. Oh, no. Oh,
that
no.
makes sense, Carl. But no, no, she's not called Missing Elliot.
It's meant to be about rock stars, though, isn't it? Missing Elliot, isn't it? So it's meant to be about rock stars,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's just cryptic, though, isn't it? Cryptic clues.
Oh, no, that's not cryptic. That's shit. You.
Right, the third one. I had a tape, and it had Umpty Dumpty on it, and.
I love when he says Umpty Dumpty. Yeah, Umpty Dumpty.
Hickory Dickory Dock and that.
yeah.
But the tapes broke.
Yeah.
That was BR. Busta Rhymes.
Say that again, I'm so stopped.
Sorry, I don't understand. What do you mean?
Who's the winner, Steve?
No, it doesn't. No, do you mean busted?
Busta. Well, it's kind of like that. Cryptic.
No, it's not. No, cryptic doesn't mean change it, so it's not the same.
Steve, who's the winner? We've got loads of right answers, so.
It's interesting, this email system,
weird,
it flashes up suspected spam. If it, you know, spam is that stuff that gets sent around the internet.
Yeah.
And it flashes that up if it thinks it's, gonna be a spam email, and every time it comes in with a Rockbusters answer, it just says suspected spam. In a sense. In a way. Let's give it to, Catherine Jakeways. From Hackney, she's got those
rubbish,
answers.
Absolute right. Rubbish. You know, talking about your parents listening, Carl, it was in Heat this week, and they mentioned that he does this thing on Sky. What is it?
It's this thing with Richard Bacon, some programme about watching telly, and you just talk about what you're watching, and that.
And he was annoyed, because he said, because his parents are out, and so he's not doing it. He's not going to turn up, because they mentioned it in Heat.
And so his parents might watch?
Yeah.
Why are you worried about that?
I don't like him watching stuff, do I? I told you. It dates back to when I did Little Donkey at school. Sure. I don't want people watching me.
What's that? Just renew us on Little Donkey? What happened?
It was just, you know, I was there to play the drums and that, in We Three Kings.
Mm-hmm.
I was loving it, you know. I got a bit carried away.
How old were you?
About 13. Right. Yeah,
really?
Probably.
Yeah.
About 10, no, about 10 probably.
Yeah.
Six.
Go on.
Between 6
where
and
8. Where old were you? What school were you at?
okay, you were playing Little Donkey.
Yeah. So, and,
No.
No,
you
but
must...
it was one of them schools where everyone sort of was in the same one. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, a Manchester school.
Just what the one classroom. Mean?
Well, it's like you-
What, sweeping chimneys in the day and then 1 hour of learning?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? What school were you at? Was it infants, junior or secondary?
They didn't really do that. It was
what,
one where-
What do you mean? You that? Did that! They still have to abide by the laws of the land in Manchester!
No, but it was a lot more- like you had infants, but you also had, like, the older lot. There's kids there who- when you're in the younger year and that, you'd see kids and
talk,
you go- is
Talk English and use terms that people do when they're talking about schooling.
I don't even want to talk about this.
No, how old were you? What
I'm thinking, I'm guessing maybe 6 or 7 or 8.
So you went from 13 to 6?
Yeah, but like I say, it's hard to remember because-
Imagine if you were giving evidence in a trial.
Yeah. How old were you? I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't really narrow it down other than 7 years either way.
You know, theoretically, he could get called up for jury service. right, you're on-
White Stripes, hardest button to button on XFM. That's a frightening thought that you came up with before the break.
Carl jury service.
Carl could be responsible for someone's rest of their life.
Yeah. Because jury service, that applies to anyone. Anyone could get sent the form. Yeah, I think you're obliged to go unless you have a really decent reason not to.
Imagine it was a really, really important trial.
Well, what annoys me is that isn't it supposed to be you're tried by 12
good
of
men
your
and
peers?
True. 12 good,
good men and true.
Yeah.
Good men and true.
But, and women, of course.
The only
days.
Thing I can hope is that the defence attorney would wheedle out Carl at an early stage.
Oh yeah, objection. I object.
Yeah.
Why?
I object. Have you heard of something called Rockbusters?
Yeah. Well, sorry, you can't just object on that. Okay, then what if I tell you my client, standing trial, is a little gay Chinese fella. And here are some of the tapes from XFM.
My what suspicion is he's prejudiced.
So how does it work then?
How does what work?
What do you mean? You just get called up and you have to do jury service unless you've got a very good reason.
And it's not, I normally have Mondays off.
Yeah. Oh, you wouldn't like that. You have to get there at 9 o'clock.
I've got to prepare monkey news.
Yeah. Oh, you couldn't stand it.
Just wouldn't do it. I wouldn't.
What would you say?
Say, oh, don't get me involved. Because I got involved once.
Don't get me involved!
No.
What do you mean you got involved once?
Well, with the police and that, when I lived in Manchester, I saw a bit of car crime going on.
Right.
And I got involved. Hassle. I'm telling you.
How did you get involved? You phoned the police?
Yeah. Yeah. Because I Snitch. Thought, well, I know, well, that's just it, but I thought, I'd hope somebody
Grass.
Did it with my ca- well.
Yeah.
So, and it was just a hassle. Loads of phone calls.
Canary.
Having to stand on a balcony of this, you know, tower block that I lived in. Police shouting up at me. I'm stood there with my underpants on. Right. And what it was, a car had been robbed, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I call up this- They call up the police and that, right? Said, right, listen, car's being robbed. And they said, where is it? I said, I don't know, just across the road from where I live, right? So I tell them where I live. And
where
they go,
do you live? How old are you, 13?
So she's asking loads of questions and that. I'm saying, look, whilst you're asking all this, they're actually getting away, so, you know, will we leave it? And she's like, no, we'll track it down, blah, blah, blah. So I said, well, look, I work nights.
What could you see? You could see some,
I could
lads,
see some lads
just pushing
a car.
Pushing a car.
Yeah.
That's how they steal cars in Manchester, is it?
Yeah.
Everywhere else in the country, they're getting in, they're driving them away.
In the south, they drive them away.
Exactly.
You usually sort of like
in
start
Manchester.
The engine. You get away a lot faster. what do the police do? Push their panda car after them.
Exactly.
Say, come on lads, don't cheat, don't get in the car.
Exactly.
They're just pushing it.
It was late at night and that. And
oh, okay.
You don't want to start the engine.
Because you don't
want to
wake people up,
right?
Not when you're nicking cars. Of course you don't.
All right.
No.
So,
no.
So when it, is it
late at night? Hold on, they weren't gay. They weren't gay, were they? They're out late, really. Come on, Carl. So what happened?
So, anyway, I said, look, don't call me back. I'm going out of bed, right? I've got work in a bit.
Brilliant.
So,
That's good. What?
So that was that, right?
Where are you working?
Next thing, right, phone's going. Hello, it's the police again. I said, oh, I told you not to call me.
Right? I told you not to call me at home.
So, they said, right, the police are outside. Can you go on your balcony? It's like, oh. So I'm 10 stories up, right? Stood on the balcony with like, me underpants on.
Yeah.
Right? And the police are saying, where's the car? And I'm saying, I don't know, they've gone down that road now. So I'm trying to point to them. They're shouting up, saying which road and all that. And I just thought, why did they get involved?
Yeah.
I don't think they found it.
No.
It was hassle.
Blokes were pushing it too fast.
Exactly.
They were in the next street by now, weren't they?
Don't get involved. Don't get after that.
Imagine him being on some sort of trial where it's like some sort of mob affair.
Yeah, gangland murder.
Imagine him going into the witness protection. The police just explaining to him, your new name is Jeffrey Peters.
Why can't I be called Bruce Wayne?
Well, no. Mr. Pilkington, listen. Imagine that. Do you know what witness protection is?
Oh, go on.
Amazing.
Look, it's when, supposing you were to give evidence against the mafia. Right, you've done a job for them and now you have to give evidence against them, right?
Cause right, well, if you're gonna do, I mean, all I did was a two kids nicking a car. Yeah. Don't start messing with mafia.
No, listen, of course not, no. But so imagine you were in the mafia and, that you got caught doing something, but instead of going to prison for the rest of your life, you said, oh, well, I can give you Mr. Big, yeah? So I go, okay, give us Mr. Big and we'll let you off, right? So the police go, right, okay.
I got handed this leaflet in Soho. Yeah.
So, you say, okay, well, I'll give you names. They go, right, we'll get evidence in court. And you go, yeah. They go, right, we'll have to get your way because you'll be done for. So you give us all the names of Mr. Big, right? We'll give you a new identity, a new passport. We'll get you, let you go and live in Canada for the rest of your life with Suzanne, right?
So why have I got to do all that?
Because they'll bump you off, won't they?
How did you know it was me?
Because you have to give evidence in court. So they go, oh, Pilkington squealed.
So you got to change all your life.
Yes.
Yeah.
They've killed someone. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, look, you just know. No, you're giving them in just to keep you from going to jail. So you don't want to spend the rest of your life in prison because you're involved in something or sorts or whatever. Doesn't matter, Carl.
No,
listen.
I'm just. How would the mafia know that I've said something?
Because you say in court, those are the people. That's he's Mr. Big. He's Mr. So and So. He ordered the hit. Don't you know anything?
It's a lot of messing around, though, isn't it?
But
so I've got to leave this job, yeah?
Yeah, I think they might try XFM first.
I'd have to, what? I'd have to bin Suzanne, would I?
No, she'd go and live with you.
You have to cut off all your ties with your friends and family, though. You can't contact them. You've got to leave them behind.
Would she have to change her haircut?
Possibly.
When did the murder happen?
Yeah. What would the new identity be that you choose? What would you choose for yourself?
What name?
Probably, I wanted to be called Brett when I was a kid.
Okay.
Right. Brett what?
Brett Pilkington.
You got to change your surname, yeah?
Yeah.
Maybe go ex-directory.
Where would you move to?
Probably back up north.
No.
Well, no.
No, don't do that. Don't do that. Can I suggest, maybe, Brett Hansen? And go and live in Australia or Canada or something. Well, maybe when they're not operating, maybe, you know, and they just forget it.
You might have to change your identity as well. You might have to grow your hair. Well, you can't grow your hair, but maybe wear a wig or a moustache.
What would you do? What would you wear?
So, like an afro or something?
Something like that.
That would be brilliant. That would be absolutely brilliant.
And I've got to do
brilliant.
all that just because for 5 minutes I stood in a court thing.
Yes.
And said he's the one who did it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, why can't I just wear the afro and the glasses when I'm in the court? Say my name's Brett, right?
Yeah.
Change my voice a bit. He did it, and they go, thanks very much. I go off, I carry on my life.
That's
still coming in on Saturday.
I don't know why they haven't thought
that. That is genius.
All the witness protection scheme.
Why don't they do that?
Yeah.
So they go, well, I'll go to court as Brett Hansen
yeah.
with an afro, and I don't like that.
Yeah.
Right? And then when I come out, I'm back to Carl Pilkington, still talking like that, but yeah. without the afro. That is perfect. Why don't you call the FBI and say, listen, I can save you billions of dollars a year. You're a genius, Carl.
Alright.
Well done.
Or Brett, should I say. Don't look back into the sun, Libertines on XFM. I'm excited, Steve. It's that time. It's that time of the week.
Go on.
Well, Carl's in a little film.
Oh, that's what you're excited about.
Yeah.
Sorry, I thought you meant the show's almost over.
Yeah, no. Come on in, Carl.
Right, so, yeah, I'm in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Took a scene from it.
Yeah.
Gotta listen carefully in that. At the end, there'll be a question on, like, the clip that you've just heard. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like what they do in the Krypton Factor and stuff. So, do you want to read out the prizes? Or just
Yeah, little things. It's a couple of rock and roll albums. We've got the
Why is it called One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest?
I can't remember. I think it's explained in the book, but I don't remember. I haven't read it for many years.
If someone knows, just a quick email to do. I'd like to know that.
Ricky.Gervais@xfm.co.uk. You can win yourself, if you get the question right, the League of Gentlemen Series 3. We've got that Rock and Roll Legends again, The Best of Blondie, a nature programme, and the Old Grey Whistle Test, Volume 3. So if you're
Brilliant,
over
so
50,
well worth,
you'll enjoy that.
Yeah.
And just, if you haven't seen the film, it's just about, like a... What would you call it?
It's a guy who thinks he's going to get away with prison by going into a mental institution.
Yeah.
It was a new experiment, but he finds out he can't get out and he's sort of trapped. And well, people know it. Everyone knows what.
Just play it.
I saw it last week, so
just play it.
All right.
Well, you know, I've been observing you here now for the last 4 weeks, and I don't see any evidence of mental illness at all.
Yeah, no, I'm not mental. I never said I was. I mean, all right, I got an E in history, but that isn't why I'm in here. I'm in here because I had to get away from the outside world. It was doing me head in. I've been working too hard. I'm stressed out. I've been working like loads of hours Monday to Friday. I've been working on a Saturday with Ricky and Steve. Right, that's been doing me head in. People think that's a laugh when it isn't. Right?
You busy right now, are you? You got something to do right now?
See, this is why I'm here today, Doctor, because he's doing me head in.
What do you mean, sir?
Well, he's doing me head in. I came in here to get away from Ricky. He is just as bad.
I was smarter than him, ain't I?
You're an idiot, right? You just...
we're just good friends.
No, we're not friends. And if you were a friend, you wouldn't be doing that to me, Ed.
How do you mean that?
Well, don't ask...
Come on, I'll show you.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
Lord,
yes,
you
yes. Bunk. Get him out.
Get him off me! Get him off!
Now, you just hold it right there. All right.
Will you get off? Doctor, will you tell him?
Come here, don't hurt you, does it?
Of course it does.
That's it. Now hold on to it. Not too hard. You'll crush all the air out of it, won't you?
Get off! I normally does it harder than this.
No. It's warming up. Warming up.
What's wrong with you?
All right, be there. Go.
Get off. See what I mean, Doctor? That's what he's doing every day. The state of this. I don't know why you do it, because it's not as if you're going to crack it open.
But I tried, didn't I? God damn it. At least I did that.
I love it, the effort.
Yeah. It's almost, I wonder if it's almost a strange premonition of the future.
Yeah.
You in some kind of home.
Alright, well,
What's the question?
Little question then. What result did I get in history?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Alright.
Yeah, well, tricky one that. Ricky.Gervais@xfm.co.uk.
Or text, will we take text?
I can't really bother to check the text.
Alright then, email.
Oh. Thanks for that, Rick.
Sneezy.
Yeah.
All right, I'll play,
Prinish Brothers, yeah, it's a lovely tune from their album, what's it called? Yours, Mine and Ours. Blinded by the Stars. See me like a passion that took such a long time. Blinded by the Stars from the Prinish Brothers. We've, a couple of, texts. I do occasionally have a look at them.
Go on.
We've had one here complaining. It doesn't say who it's from. It just says, wow, really clever homophobic material. Genius. Switching off, idiots. I don't know what they mean. It was not clever homophobic material. It was just homophobic.
Well, what do they mean, though?
But how is it homophobic? We weren't being anti-gay. We were saying we don't understand the gay world.
And anything that's...
We were querying and questioning
and, it. Yeah, and Carl... See, this is what I mean. Carl gets us into trouble. I can't go through Chinatown anymore.
No.
It's not really a town, though, is it?
It's not really a town. It's more of a novelty street.
Novelty street with restaurants. Yeah. But I can't, you know, and when we sort of like talk, we get tarred with the same brush as him because the man's an idiot.
Yeah.
But we often say that. We are not homophobic. I don't think Carl's homophobic. He's confused. Mm. He's interested. He's got nothing against Chinese people. He's got a little theory that they don't age well. And these are the sort of things that come across. I mean, they're not meant to be homophobic and racist. They're showing that Carl, I don't know the PC term for this, is a bit mental.
Yes.
And, you know, I think we're doing our bit by letting him on the air as well. Like that complaint he got about that woman on, what's it called? Who are you looking at?
Yeah.
Because he said about, I don't even want to repeat it, but he said some, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, but I never meant to upset anyone with that.
That's, no, I know you didn't. No, I know you didn't, no. But, I mean, it's on a website now. And, you know, to be fair, she does say it was Carl that said it, and, you know, we were the idiot presenters that let him on air. But it's like, Carl is bad for our reputation.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean? It's funny to be in a room with him, but then I want to sort of shake it off.
Yeah.
And I don't know what to do about
it. Guilty by association.
I know. What have you got to say for yourself, Carl, for some of the stuff you come out with? What have you got to say? I mean, I know the answer. It's absolutely from the heart and genuine
ignorance.
And confusion and interest. You haven't got a malicious bone in your body.
Well. Towards me, yes, but yeah, other people.
But again, he's just honest with you. He says,
repeat what he says.
No,
don't repeat it. Just leave it.
But it's not as bad as some other things. But he's, you know, he says, remember you say that when you first met him, he looked a bit odd, but you got used to it.
Yeah.
Now that's from the heart. That's like him sort of like being honest and nice, but he doesn't know what that. And we can take it, of course.
Well.
What have you got to say for yourself?
I haven't got anything to say, really. I mean, there's been other weird stuff going on in the week and that.
Go on.
No, I might as well talk about it next week, because we're wrapping up. All I'm saying is I talk about what's gone on.
Yeah. Have we got monkey news? Have we left monkey news behind?
Monkey news! Come on!
What happened?
You can't offend monkeys!
I'll tell you what is annoying.
What?
Steve's told me about a film that is about a monkey going off with a woman.
Mm.
The Charlotte Rampling thing where she
It's a film called Max Monomour. Yeah, she has an affair with a monkey. Go on.
Yeah.
Oh, what happened?
You wouldn't like
Don't
it.
Go, we can't go into
You wouldn't
any
like
monkeys.
It. You wouldn't like it. It's not like, it's weird and you wouldn't, Carl, it's not like a nature programme where he wears a bowler hat and can talk. Okay? The nature programmes that you seem to see.
Yes, I'm trying to think why I've seen that one.
No! Yeah. Come on, do monkey news.
Well, monkey news this week.
Play the
jingle. Oh, chimpanzee, that monkey news, you
Right, it's about this monkey that was knocking about in the 1950s.
Right.
It was known in the sort of LA area. Right. And apparently, again, I haven't really checked all this out, I've just picked up bits that look interesting.
Yeah.
No. Wore a golden mask, and like a cape and a leopard skin belt and stuff, right? So people didn't know
that he was a monkey. Of course they didn't know, yeah.
They thought he was this bloke who's going around and he was helping out crime situations and stuff.
Right, you're an idiot. So one, this disguise, that you see a 3'6" bloke with arms the length of his body.
No, but that's the funny thing, right? They sort of thought, it's a bit odd, you know, he's stocky, yet extremely flexible.
Yeah, and hairy, because he only wore a white mask and a belt.
And a distinctive jawline and stuff. And then, apparently, like, he used to sort of get to his...
Nothing we say gets through, does it? You've decided you can picture this monkey going around solving crimes, and it's...
telling you.
Let him finish the story. Time's running out.
So it sort of get to its crime by, like, swinging from the trees and stuff.
Of course it would,
right?
Yeah.
But people just thought, it's a normal fella.
Of course.
Then what happened was, he...
This is the bit that's gonna annoy me, isn't it?
He helped some fellas out, like, you know, and for a reward, they were like, do you want some money? You know, you've helped save our lives during a crime and stuff.
Mm.
Do you want some money in that? And he just went straight for the shopping bags, got a couple of bananas and apples, right? And as he was bent down, looking into the bag, getting the bananas and apples, they pulled his mask off, little monkey.
So he wasn't allowed to work for the police anymore?
It ended there.
Sure.
Weird, isn't it?
Rick, can I tell you the meaning of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest?
Yeah.
Can we never speak of monkey news again?
Yeah.
It comes apparently from an American children's nursery rhyme. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all good children go to heaven, some fly east, some fly west, some fly over the cuckoo's nest.
Brilliant.
And our thanks to Ian for emailing that in. Shall I give, someone the prizes?
Yeah.
Phil Corbett, there you are, that's the first one I've pulled out. He correctly guessed that it was E. It was an E that Carl got in history, the only qualification he's got, and it's an E.
Do you know that woman?
judge the monkey news based on that.
Go on.
That woman who went out with the monkey.
What?
It's a film.
It's a film.
It was Charlotte Rampling. in the film. I don't know who played the monkey.
Did she have any kids?
What, with the monkey? In the film?
Yeah, I'm just thinking if I'm gonna get it out and stuff.
No.
Hmm.
Why?
Oh, cause that would have been interesting.
Well, no, it's just that the problem there is the kids would always look more like the dad.